Welcome to the Weekend Adventure. This weekend we're doing something a little bit different. Wendy and I get to spend a lot of time outside in the outdoors, and sometimes we're caught in remote places where there's not a lot of people around.
That's right, and no matter how prepared you are, you can never be too prepared. So today we're going to learn some wilderness survival skills from a really good instructor.
So for anyone that spends any great amount of time outside, or any amount of time outside whatsoever, boating, hunting, fishing, anything along those lines, this is a really great episode. Come with us, we're about to get our hands dirty, we're pretty excited, so let's go.
Stay tuned.
The Weekend Adventurer Canada is brought to you by the Kenora Hospitality Alliance.
So we're here today with Dave McDonald from International Canadian School of Survival, and he's going to tell us about what we're going to do.
So hi, my name's Dave. I started this school because I was a search and rescue technician with the Air Force. I've seen a lot of people get in a lot of bad situations, whether they're out boating or skidooing or quadding or whatever, flying in the north, going to work. So I've seen a lot of people suffer, and I want to try and end the suffering a bit and hopefully promote having a good time in the woods and being prepared.
So today
we're going to go out and we're going to go through the survival pattern, because we teach a pattern, the same pattern that the Canadian Air Force teaches their Air Force and Air Crew. And we're going to go through it. So it goes first aid, fire, shelter, signals, water, and food. And you can use the pattern during any scenarios under any environment, whether it's on land, in the air, in the woods, above the tree line, below the tree line, the survival pattern works. You manipulate it to suit the environment you're in and the equipment you have.
That sounds great. So where do we get started?
So we're going to start off with the environmental injuries, and we're going to talk about some of the threats out here.
Perfect.
As we're standing here right now, what kind of environmental hazards are we faced with? Like if we broke a leg or something, or somebody twisted an ankle and was left here and you had to go get help, and
yeah,
they were here, they could be here for a couple of hours,
right,
maybe even overnight.
So wildlife?
Possibly, yeah. Wildlife, it definitely could be a hazard.
Sun exposure.
Mm-hmm. Sun exposure is a big one.
Dehydration, hypothermia
if it rains, because it doesn't have to be below zero for you to get hypothermia, right?
Mm-hmm.
You just got to get chilled and then,
yeah.
And what else? More prevalent, it's around us right now.
Mosquitoes?
The bugs.
Yes.
So we could talk about how to avoid these things, right? Obviously with the predators, you don't want to leave food products around.
Right.
If you're a woman who has that time of the month, obviously you don't want to leave that laying around anywhere, neither. Dispose of it away from your camp.
Mm-hmm.
You can't really burn it off, because every time I've left a campfire and come back, it's always dug up by something.
Really?
Yeah.
Because there's still some residue of the food left over,
right,
and the animals come to it, right?
Yeah.
Even in the summer when I'm in the woods, I wear two layers of clothing all the time, because I find I could put up with the heat, but I can't put up with the bugs as well.
Yeah.
And the bugs will go through the fabric on one layer.
Yeah, they will.
But they cannot go through two layers.
Right.
Okay.
They can't seem to mesh or meet up that mesh, right?
Okay.
Obviously, another hazard is getting lost.
Yep.
So how do we stop from getting lost?
Maps.
Yes. So proper
maps
and compass work.
Yeah.
So if you've never had map, compass, and GPS, or you've never done any work with it, you should probably get some proper training and learn how to use it properly. Obviously, if you follow the needle north, you're gonna head north.
Right.
But always carry a compass, and I carry a Silver Ranger. I find it's one of the better ones out there. I've had this one for 15 years. So.
Okay.
Okay, never go in the woods without a compass.
Right, good to know.
If we do confront a bear today, or a bear confronts us, we are gonna stick together as a group. There's no yelling and screaming, there's no running away.
Sacrificing.
We're gonna make, disable the person beside you and run. and we're gonna make a big front, because the bear doesn't want to get injured. No animals want to get injured when they're trying to get food. They want an easy meal, so we're not gonna be an easy meal.
Okay.
We're gonna line up and look big and look like we're not scared.
Okay.
So next we're gonna do a little bit of fire starting. We're gonna practice it first, and then I'm gonna show you how to actually get a little fire going. We won't do too much fire today because of the fire hazard's a little high in the bush.
Okay.
Things are starting to get a little bit dry, finally, here in Manitoba.
Yeah.
So fire needs four things, really. You need a spark, you need oxygen, you need tinder, and you need fuel, okay? The spark, oxygen, and tinder are first, and then you add the fuel as you go, and you obviously increase it in size.
Okay.
Okay, you start off super small, and work your way up. Here's a sparker, blast match it's called. Okay. This is the best product I've found out there because you can use it one-handed. So if you had an injured arm or hand, you could still use this piece of equipment.
Okay.
You put thumb pressure on the clip that holds it together, and then you force down.
Oh.
Okay, and you can also rotate the flint. Redundancy is the key, right?
Yep.
So I always carry a minimum of three ways to light a fire.
Okay.
My lighter for a quick one, the blast match is a last resort or just to practice with, and also some matches in a waterproof container. So we're gonna start off with the blast match and cotton balls.
Okay.
Okay, so here's each a cotton ball.
Okay.
Remember that fire likes edges.
Okay.
So you need to
separate it a bit.
Separate. You don't even need a whole cotton ball. You could probably use a half a cotton ball quite easily.
Okay.
So this is a cotton ball on its own with the blast match.
Oh, wow.
Okay, and I guarantee it work every time if you practice with your blast match. If you didn't have cotton balls, but you had a first aid kit, you can always go in there
and
use the dressing.
Right.
Okay.
And you can pull the cotton
right
out of the dressing.
That's really good to know.
Okay. So when you're at that stage, when it's flaming like that, when do you go to the next stage and how quickly, what do you use?
Well, quite quickly. And of course, I always use birch bark
because
it's Mother Nature's kerosene.
It is.
You can see it burns black like kerosene.
Yeah.
The only problem is if it's a reddish tinge, like the young birch trees with the reddish bark on them,
right,
it just melts. It doesn't catch fire.
Yeah. Okay.
It just shrivels and melts, eh? Mm-hmm. But birch bark works great.
Okay. So that's like two little steps that you did there and you've already got a pretty impressive flame going.
Yeah, and I could just keep feeding this birch bark.
Right.
And you can see there's lots of birch trees around here. Okay, so let's go through a couple other things. Bird's nest or a mouse nest works really good too. Bird's nests normally are better because they're high and dry.
Yep.
They're up off the ground and they're dry in the wind. TP, toilet paper, works awesome. I always carry some, so I always have some with me. Alcohol swabs, those antiseptic swabs, they alcohol in them. They catch fire real easy.
Okay.
Something else you can use is a Vaseline gauze dressing. Okay, you can also use wasp nests. Obviously, you want to make sure there's no wasps in it.
It's incredible how, with just a few small things, it can solve the entire issue of having to start a fire.
That's right.
You know, when you're out. I mean, it's not like any of these things really take up a lot of room.
And,
but they're essential to have with you.
And the skills and techniques are the lightest in your pack and the easiest to carry.
That's right. Yeah.
Right? And that's really what saves you, is your brain, right?
Yeah.
So fire needs four things, really. You need a spark, you need oxygen, you need tinder, and you need fuel. Okay? The spark, oxygen, and tinder are first, and then you add the fuel as you go, and you obviously increase it in size.
Okay.
So we're gonna pick a bush bundle. I suggest you keep two of them in your shelter or in a dry place at all times so that it's easier to get a fire going. I've seen people in situations where they were camping out overnight, they forgot to dry their boots. And when they woke up next morning, they were frozen solid and they couldn't get their feet in their boots.
Oh, lovely.
Now in a survival situation, that's devastating, right?
Right.
But if you have the proper materials already at your campsite, like bush bundles and birch bark, you can get a fire going real quick and you can get your boots thawed off and get your feet warm.
So what is a bush bundle?
So a bush bundle is the bottom of the spruce trees, the dead branches at the bottom that don't get much for sunlight.
Okay.
And we will take a bunch of them and we will make a big bouquet, like it's Mother's Day and you want to get something from your mother.
Okay.
Okay, so you can see that difference in size.
Yeah.
See how fine mine is?
Yours is very fine. Mine.
Yes. Yours would be like the second one to go on me.
Okay, I see.
So we've got our tinder and we've got our kindling.
Yep.
Now we need fuel.
Right.
So obviously you look around. Oh, well, I was just here picking the bush bundles from this tree. So let's pick some bigger branches. Now we have the small fuel, now we need to obviously increase the size. So just follow me.
Okay.
Now we collect up all of this. And then for extra fuel, like to last me overnight or for to a length of time, I'll pull over a tree. I don't suggest people carry an axe unless you know how to use an axe or you've practiced with an axe, because an axe is one of the most dangerous things out there in the woods.
Okay.
Because if you get tired or you don't know how to use it, you make mistakes and you take it in the foot or the shin.
Right. Oh. So.
And then you're in a survival situation with only one leg functioning.
Right.
Problems. And I have flameage. Now, fire likes to climb.
Okay.
So I usually hold it up.
Okay.
Put the bush bundle down.
Yep.
Obviously the wind direction's a little off. And then I go in larger fuel. Okay, so that's fire.
Yeah.
And that took relatively easy. Yeah, that took all of like a few minutes.
It doesn't take long, it's just a few minutes, right? Even hypothermic, freezing cold, you can still do it, no problem.
Yeah,
it was just like a few basic steps in the bush, collecting what you need, and then having the right
equipment. Having everything there, right. Having the right technique, and then you're off to the races, right?
Sweet.
You're having a shore lunch and relaxing while you wait for help.
Let's go.
So next in the survival pattern after fire is shelters. What does shelter provide you?
Shade.
Shade, for sure. So protection from the sun, what else?
Protection from the wind.
Wind, all the elements, really, right? Yeah. Rain, wind, sun, all the cold even.
Yeah.
Right. It protects you. So also psychologically, having a shelter and a place to kind of call your own when you're in the woods is of great benefit.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to do a basic lean-to with a tarp because it'll be the easiest to do out here right now. And I always carry a tarp.
Okay.
I suggest you carry a tarp that's 12 feet by 16 feet.
Okay.
And that way you can get two people into it quite easily, quite comfortably.
So carry that in your boat or your vehicle always?
Yeah, always. Yeah, it's just a blue tarp. They're not very expensive.
Right.
They're easy to carry, easy to pack around, right?
Yeah. Exactly.
Great emergency shelter. Okay, cool.
All right, so let's get started.
Let's get started. So I look for two trees, the right distance apart, which is usually arm's length plus a foot.
Okay.
That allows an adult to lay down or a person to lay down and still have a couple of feet of room for equipment.
Right.
Okay.
And storage of fire materials and stuff, right? This one here is a little bit narrow, but we're going to use it for this demonstration.
Sure.
The other thing I look around for, I'm looking for hazards, any overhead hazards, any big dead standing trees that could snap off in the middle of the night and come down on me.
Well,
I don't see anything, which is great.
So we cut down these trees, and now we have to cut off every branch, these boughs. These are going to be the bedding for our shelter. And, well, I don't know, what are we using these for? Nothing?
Yes, the poles. We use every part of the tree.
Okay.
I waste nothing. I reuse everything.
So
we'll use the poles as part of the shelter frame, and then the boughs are the shelter bed.
This is a lot of work.
To build a proper shelter, you need approximately 15 spruce trees.
What?
Yes. Because you want the bed 12 to 18 inches deep. So that's from the tip of your finger to your elbow normally. That's how deep you want your bough bed.
How wide?
Why?
Yeah.
Insulation from the cold ground, from the wet ground.
Okay.
Comfort.
Okay.
Right? Anybody can be uncomfortable in the woods.
Even if we're a hard bed kind of girl?
Yes.
All right.
It's a lot of work in this survival business. So we just finished trimming up some spruce trees for our shelter. It's really hot, really muggy, a lot of bugs. So
Now's an important time to take a little bit of a break and make sure that we're staying hydrated. Drink lots of water. Dave tells us that's one of the most important things is dehydration, to avoid it. So
that's right.
We're going to have some water and take a break. And when we come back, we're going to finish building our shelter.
Cheers.
Cheers. Welcome back to the show. We are in the process of building our shelter. We're just about to start. We've got our poles from the trees all nice and cleaned up. And now what's our next step?
Now we're going to do the ridge pole, which is the pole that goes across the two trees. Usually keep it about chest height so that when you're sitting in your sitting logs, when you stand up, you don't crank your head on it.
Okay.
And that's why we trimmed off all the branches flush too, so they weren't going to be a hazard.
Right.
Pick up your tree.
Right.
Next thing, I take my tarp out. Again, this is 12 by 16. So if you can help me spread it out so it's fairly even. We're gonna girth hitch it, so we're gonna take it like this. Run that end through. Take the loop. Yeah, take the loop. Put it back through. Center it and you can tie it on. So next we're gonna put a log in here to hold down the back of the tarp. And then we're gonna put in our rafter poles, which would be four or five poles going up the side here. Now for angle of the material, you want a 45 to 55 degree angle so it sheds all the rain and snow.
Okay.
And it doesn't sit and form pockets on the tarp, and
right,
then it will eventually find a way through, right?
Right.
Okay. Stick them on this side of that pole. That way it holds the base of these ones. Key is to have the material tight. No matter what material you're using, it needs to be nice and tight. So now we're gonna go back and get the boughs.
Yep.
And the coarse boughs, the really thick stemmed ones, we want those on the bottom.
Okay.
Right, because we don't want those in our back.
No.
We want the fine ones. We want them sleeping on a nice bed.
Right. Nice and soft.
Let's do it. So basically this is a lean-to shelter with tarp. The bed looks like it's got a lot of insulation padding in it, but as soon as you lay on that, it goes down to nothing, and by morning, it's only going to be a couple inches thick.
Right.
You're going to have to add more branches, so that's why I say 12 to 18 inches
right.
of good insulation. Plus, it comes down to comfort. It'd be so much more comfortable. Loftier beds, you know, you just
right.
relax.
Right. So this looks pretty comfortable.
It does, actually. It looks super comfortable.
Somebody grab a lay down there and check it out.
All right.
Together.
Okay. So we've got a nice little cuddle going on here.
I'm hot.
I know.
Like, it's
pretty
warm.
In our makeshift little lean-to, it's not bad. Like, comfort level is pretty good.
It is. You
I
know
have
what?
To
in
say.
All honesty, if you're out in the
bush.
Yeah. And this is where you have to sleep. I mean, really, what is your alternative?
This is it. And you know what? It's not bad. Like, I could sleep here. So far, we've been through first aid, fire, and shelter. And now we're moving on to the next segment of the show, which includes what?
Signals. Things you can use for signals is a signaling mirror. Most effective, obviously, on a bright sunny day.
And how well can they pick that up, like in the sky?
So well, a boat on the ocean or a plane in the distance, you can't even see it, but they can see your signal mirror. Something else you could use is a glow stick.
Yeah.
Carry glow sticks on you. There's other audio signals too, a whistle. Bear bangers can be used as a signal or flares.
Right.
Go big and go home when it comes to signals. It's really important to stay hydrated. So what I recommend is you carry purification tablets for emergency. They're fairly cheap, and there's one or two will clean a liter of water.
Okay.
Also, I recommend that you always carry a water bottle with you. A metal one, stainless steel, is usually better. It's something you can't see through.
Okay.
Because if it's swamp water and it's got lots of floaties and stuff in it, or if it's snow that's been melted around a campfire and it's got lots of coals, ash and stuff
debris.
In it, debris in it, you won't want to drink it.
Right.
So out of sight, out of mind, you'll drink more.
Makes sense.
Something else I always suggest you carry is a tin can so that you can purify your water in the campfire, right? So fill it full of snow or fill it full of water and then boil it up and pour it into your water bottle or drink it straight out of the can after it's cooled. If you're out there and you have no way to purify your water, you have no way to get a fire going, you have no way to melt snow or whatever, then you're going to have to consume water. You just can't go without water for any more than you know, a day.
So that's it for today. We've had a really informative day. We've learned a lot from Dave about how to survive in the outdoors and a lot of crucial tips that are key in even being a part of the outdoors.
Yeah, just getting out and being in the outdoors. It's better to be safe than sorry, and it'll add so much confidence to you, and you'll have so much more fun, and you'll feel so much safer out.
And you run three different types of courses.
I run wilderness safety and survival courses, three levels. I run the advanced wilderness survival, which is 5 days. I run predator safety and survival firearms, where you get to shoot 22s and shotguns and rifles and flares and bear bangers and bear spray and all the rest of the stuff. Also do navigation, basic land navigation, 2 days, map, compass, and GPS. Mm-hmm. And also cold water immersion for those interested. They're out in late fall, winter skidooing, if they go through the ice.
Ice fishing.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Ice fishing. It's nice to know what to do before it happens to you.
And where do we find more information on this?
You can go to our website, which is at www.survivalbytraining.com.
Okay.
And everything's in there, all the courses, all the tips, all the equipment lists, and where to find the equipment too.
Perfect.
So thanks so much for watching. This week was really, really fun. Make sure to check out our Facebook page, and we'll have all the information on there as well with a link to Dave's site. And stay tuned for some more exciting episodes.
See you next week.
Thanks.
Now add a little bit of earwax or chapstick.
Earwax.
Petroleum product.
Okay.
And it's even more flammable.
Do you collect your own earwax?
If I'm in the bush, I do. I have no qualms about it.
Don't worry, Dan loves to edit.
So you can strike them on a zipper or a rock or whatever.
Your tooth?
Your tooth, yeah. I've seen people do that too. I don't suggest that, by the way. Ow!
I guess so.
No dead there.
Sorry.
User error. What's another way to get rescued? Deck of cards. You start playing solitary,
oh, yeah.
And somebody's gonna look over your shoulder and go, that's the next move. Every time.